السلام عليكم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا وقدوتنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، all praise due to Allah سبحانه وتعالى and peace be upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. I testify that there is no God except Allah, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. My brothers and sisters in Islam, I greet you all with the greetings of Islam, and I say to every single one of you, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always for this great opportunity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants us to be from amongst those who are the guests of Allah, to learn more about Allah and to understand the deen of Allah azza wa jal. And tonight, inshaAllah, we will resume with last week's chapter, in which we started talking about remembrance of death and restraint of wishes. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, at the beginning, he had forbidden the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum from visiting the graveyards. At the beginning, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum and commanded them, I forbid you from visiting the graveyards. Then few months later, down the track, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Ala inni كُنْتُ قَدْ نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ زِيَارَةِ الْقُبُورِ أَلَا فَزُورُوهَا. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that in the past I had forbidden you from visiting the graveyards. In the past I had forbidden you from visiting the graveyards. But now I urge you and encourage you that you visit the graveyards. فَإِنَّهَا تُذَكِّرُكُمْ بِالْمَوْتِ. Why? Because it reminds you of death. So it's recommended in Islam for us to remind ourselves of death, which is our final destination. A destination that no one can escape. No one can run away from. It's a destination that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had ordained upon every single living soul. Every single human being. My brothers and my sisters, every single human being and every single jinn and every single animal and every single angel and every single living being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed upon him to die. Something amazing takes place in the hereafter. So amazing, so astonishing. In the hereafter, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the angel of death, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the angel of the trumpet, the angel of trumpet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the angel of trumpet in the hereafter to blow in the trumpet, to breathe in the trumpet. And we all know that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the angel of the trumpet to blow in the trumpet, it is the end of this world. Even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, how can I relax? How can I relax knowing that the angel of the trumpet had grabbed on the trumpet, staring at the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, awaiting the command of Allah azza wa jal, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to command the angel of the trumpet to blow in the trumpet. And that's where the angel of the trumpet will blow in the trumpet and end this world. And obviously ends by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command the angel of the trumpet. And what's the name of the angel of trumpet? The name of the angel of the trumpet is Israfil. Israfil is one of those great angels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him the task of blowing in the trumpet. When he blows in the trumpet the first time, it is the blowing of the sa'aq, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes it to be, the blowing of destruction, the end of this world, the blowing of destruction, the end of this world. So once he blows in the trumpet the first time, it's the end of this world. That's it, this world ends. And all those things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes to us in the Quran al-Kareem and depicts to us in the Holy Quran happens after Israfil alayhi salam blows in the trumpet. And then, after the blowing of the first trumpet, in which every single living thing will die. Every single living thing will die. Nothing that has a living soul will continue to live. Every single living thing will die. That includes human beings, people like us, jinn, which are another race, another being, angels, will die, and all the other beings that we know of and we don't even know of, they will all die after the blowing of the first trumpet. But something amazing takes place after the second, after the first trumpet, because after the first trumpet, there's a gap of 40, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam makes mention. 40. The Sahaba asked, O Messenger of Allah, that gap between the first blowing of the trumpet and the blowing of the second trumpet, that 40, that gap of 40, is it 40 years, 40 days, 40 months, 40 weeks, 40 hours? And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam just said, 40. It could be 40 days, it could be 40 hours, it could be 40 weeks, it could be 40 months, it could be 40 years, it could be 40 centuries. At the end of the day, the calculation of time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is different to our calculation. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also makes mention in the Quran al-Kareem, وَإِنَّ يَوْمًا عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ مِمَّا تَعُدُّونَ. One day to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is equivalent to 1,000 days. So our calculation of time is different to the calculation of time with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's two blowing of trumpets. The first one, which is called the blowing of destruction, and the second one, which is called the blowing of resurrection. So the first blowing of trumpet, everyone dies. The second blowing of trumpet, everyone is resurrected. That's why the first one is called the blowing of destruction, and the second one is called the blowing of al-ba'ath, resurrection. But that's not my talk, that's not my topic tonight. I want to talk about a scene, an event that takes place between the blowing of the first trumpet, the destruction, and the blowing of the second trumpet, which is resurrection. Something amazing takes place. Something amazing, something astonishing, something that's beyond your imagination that takes place. What takes place after every single living thing and being will die, except a small number of angels. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep alive, but not permanently, just temporarily. So after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the angel of trumpet, angel Israfil, to blow in the trumpet the first time, every single living thing will die, except Israfil himself, Jibril, Mikael, the eight angels that carry the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the angel of death. So in total, 12. Eight angels that carry the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal, that's eight. Israfil, Jibrail, Mikael, that's 11. And angel of death, that's 12. So you could imagine every single living thing, every single being that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had ever created, from the human beings, from the animals, from the jinn, from the angels, and the other beings that we don't even know of, they're all dead, except there's 12 angels. So the angel of death will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say to Allah Azza wa Jal, O Allah, all your creation are dead. Every single creation of yours that you had created is dead. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks, and Allah Azza wa Jal knows better. Allah will ask the angel of death, so who stayed alive? Because Allah knows that He kept a small number of angels alive. So Allah Azza wa Jal will ask the angel of death, so who stayed alive? So the angel of death will say, Ya Allah, from all your creation that you had created, it is only Jibril, Mikael, and Israfil, the eight angels that carry your throne, and me and you who stayed alive. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Allah commands Israfil, Jibril, Mikael to die. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks the angel of death, so now who stayed alive? The angel of death will look around and realize that before this conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jibril, Israfil, Mikael were alive, but now he looks around and he finds him dead. So he says, Ya Allah, Jibril, Israfil, Mikael also died. It is only the eight angels that carry your throne and me and your greatness, me and you, who stayed alive. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the eight angels that carry his throne to die. So the angel of death, Malak al-Maut, will look around and realize that even the eight angels that carry the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also dead. And he looks around and realizes that no one is alive except him and his Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah azza wa jalla will ask him, Oh, angel of death, who stayed alive? So the angel of death will say, Ya Rab, no one stayed alive except me and you. Except me and you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the angel of death to die. The angel that has been going around taking the souls of mankind for many, many centuries and years. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make him taste death. And now, no one stays alive. Except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of life and death. Now everyone is dead. You could imagine, every single living thing is dead. Every single human being, every single animal, every single jinn, every single angel are all dead. No one is alive except Allah. Except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of death and life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do something that will even astonish you even more, that will amaze you even more. And it just wants you to contemplate and imagine that scene where everyone is dead, no one is alive, the greatest of people are dead, the greatest of angels are dead, the greatest of jinns are dead, the greatest of the creation of Allah Azza wa Jalla are dead, even the angels that carry the throne of Allah Azza wa Jalla that the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam describes, one of them, that the distance from their earlobe to their shoulder is 1,000 years journey on a quick and a fast Arabian horse. They are all dead. And who's alive? Who? Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal is the only one that stays alive. Because he is the one that described himself Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum Alladhi La Yamut. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the everlasting living one that never dies. So what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? And I just want you to imagine that scene. Everyone is dead except Allah. Everyone is dead except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Azza wa Jalla starts to say, Aina al-mutakabbirun? Aina al-mutajabbirun? Where are those with pride and where are those with glory? Liman al-mulku al-yawm? To whom is the kingdom today? Who is the great one? Who is the Lord? Where are those with pride? Where are those with glory? Where are those with wealth? Where are you today? لِمَنْ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ To whom is the kingdom today? Who is the Lord? Obviously, no answer. Because you know what? There's no one alive to even answer. Allah is asking a question, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not even receiving a response. Why? Because everyone is dead. So Allah azza wa jalla asks again the second time. Where are those with pride and where are those with glory? لمن الملك اليوم? To whom is the kingdom today? Who is the Lord? And again, my brothers and my sisters in Islam, no answer comes back to Allah because no one is alive to even answer Allah Azza wa Jal. And a third time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks, where are those with pride? Where are those with glory? لمن الملك اليوم? To whom is the kingdom today? Who is the Lord? Who is the one with pride? And who is the one with glory? And no one answers Allah Azza wa Jalla the third time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Lord, answers himself and replies back to himself, لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only one, the irresistible. Allahu Akbar. What a scene. What a scene. Just think about it. Allah is asking, no response. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking, no reply. And obviously no reply because everyone is dead. There's not even one person, not even a living thing that's alive for them to even reply back to Allah Azza wa Jal. And what's the question of Allah? What are those with glory? What are those with pride? What are those with greatness? What happened to you today? لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ To whom is the kingdom today? Who is the Lord? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replies back to himself and Allah says, To Allah, Al-Wahid, the only one, the everlasting, Al-Qahhar, the irresistible one. Subhanallah. That's Allah. That's Allah, my brother, my sister in Islam, that sometimes we neglect. That's Allah, the one that calls upon us to pray, and we don't even pray. That's Allah, the one that commands us not to do this, and we still do it in front of Him. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَارِ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrects everyone. And the first one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrects is the angel of death. And some narrations say Israfil, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command Israfil to blow in the trumpet the second time, which is the blowing of resurrection, and then everyone will be resurrected back alive. The way they were is the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings them back alive. During the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they used to mock the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used to present to them Islam. And he used to say to them, from amongst the things that you must adhere to is to believe in Allah Azza wa Jal in one Lord, believe in the prophets and messengers, believe in the divine destiny, believe in the day of judgment, believe in this, believe in that. And from amongst the things that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to always preach, believe that after your death, there's resurrection. So they used to make mockery of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and say to him, oh Muhammad, doesn't even make sense to us that after someone passes away and then they turn into dust, they'll come back alive. So one smart person from amongst them, one smart man, that he believes he's smart, but the reality is he's dumb. He comes to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam with a handful of dust or sand. And he looks at the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he tells him, oh messenger of Allah, or Afwan, he looks at the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, tells him, oh Muhammad, because he doesn't even believe in the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. So he tells him, oh Muhammad, you claim that after we die and then we turn into dust like this, and then let's go of the dust to the ground. You claim that after we die and then we turn into dust, that your Lord will bring us back alive. This is your claim, oh Muhammad. This is your teaching. This is the religion that you came with, telling people that after they die and then they turn into dust, they're going to come back alive? How's your Lord going to bring us back alive? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied back to that question. Simple answer. The one that created you the first time will bring you the second time. So what's shocking you? Why are you surprised that after you are created and then you die and then you turn into dust, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can't bring you back alive? You should be asking, how did Allah Azza wa Jalla bring you from the very first time? Not the second time. So if it got you the first time, it's a lot more easier on Allah Azza wa Jalla to bring you the second time. So don't make yourself smart, because you're not smart, you're dumb. How is your Lord going to bring us back alive after we die and turn into dust? How did Allah Azza wa Jalla bring you from the very first time? Where were you before that? So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, yes, Allah will bring you back again. Allah will resurrect you, and Allah will recreate you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cast you in the hellfire. So my brothers and my sisters, death is a destiny upon every single person. Death, it is a decree upon every single living thing. The only one that will stay alive is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah azza wa jal is the creator and the rest of His creation is creation. So every creation has a beginning and an end. The only one that doesn't have a beginning, and that's why it doesn't have an end, that's Allah azza wa jal. هو الأول والآخر, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Himself to be, He is the first one and He is the last one. So there's no beginning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there's no end to Allah Azza wa Jal. Someone might raise, they'll come up to me and say, that doesn't make sense that there's no God before God. You know, people ask those questions, especially atheists. They ask you this question and say, okay, you believe that your Lord doesn't have a beginning, so there was no one before Him. That doesn't make sense, because everything that has a beginning, there's got to be someone that began them. Our response to that, the question itself, it's wrong. Because not everything that you ask is a valid question. Not every question that you ask is a valid question. And a good example of that is what some of the scholars had given recently, is that, for example, you've got 10 people are racing. So you've got the top three. So the one that came before the fourth is what? Who came before the fourth? The third. And the one that came before the third? Second, yes? Okay. And the one that came before the first? Who came before the first? I could see some people thinking about it. You're thinking about it, come on. It's an invalid question. Who came before the first? Well, hold on a sec. There's not such thing called who came before the first. The first is the first, that's it. It ends over there. So you can't come and ask me this question, who came before Allah Azza wa Jalla? The actual question is wrong. The actual question is wrong. You can't say who came before Allah Azza wa Jalla. And even if we accept the fact that there's another God above our God, you're just going to continue going into circles, because that God created this God, and that God created that God, and then the other God created this God, and then there's another 1,000 gods being created by 2,000 gods, that those 2,000 gods being created by another 10,000 gods. You're just going to continue going into this circle. Who started who? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the awwal and the akhir. Allah is the first one and He's the last one. No beginning, because there's no beginning, there's no end. But we, as the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have a beginning. And because we have a beginning, we have an end. And the one that began us will end us. And the one that began us and will end us is who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't mess around with Allah azza wa jal. Do not mess around with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which is very unfortunate that we believe in Allah azza wa jal. We believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that started us. And we believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will end us, but we still mess around with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How do we mess around with Allah azza wa jal? When Allah tells us to do something and we don't do it. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us not to do something and we still do it. That's messing around with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that began you and the one that will end you. So fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Abdullah ibn Umar in this first hadith that I'll read to you tonight. قال أخذ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بمنكبي فقال كن في الدنيا كأنك غريب أو عابر سبيل. I want you to pay attention to the advice of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abdullah ibn Umar, he is one of those young companions that accompanied the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was very conscious and vigilant and aware of always being around the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to learn from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He wanted the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasallam to impart the knowledge of Islam to him. So Abdullah ibn Umar, and he is the son of Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he says that one day the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam grabbed my shoulder. And that's a gesture of what? When you come and speak to someone and you put your hand on their shoulder, or you grab their shoulder, especially if there's someone younger than you. What does that mean? Pay attention. That's what it means. We're not playing games here. So when you come up to someone and you put your hands on their shoulder and tell them, look, I want to talk to you. What does that mean? Take me serious. It's a gesture from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Abdullah ibn Umar. Oh Abdullah, I'm about to give you an advice. So pay attention, be attentive. Listen to what I've got to say. Listen to what I'm about to say. What did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam say to him? 5 words. كن في الدنيا كأنك غريب أو عابر سبيل. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam gives an advice to Abdullah ibn Umar after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam captivated his attention. He says to him, O Abdullah, be in this dunya that you live in as a stranger or a fair or a wayfarer or a traveler. Be in this dunya as a stranger or a wayfarer or a stranger or a traveler. This is the advice that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving to Abdullah ibn Umar. What's this advice? O Abdullah, live in this world as a stranger or as a traveler. What does that mean? What does it mean when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is advising a young man, Abdullah ibn Umar, and we all know every advice that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had given to any of his companion, to any of his companions, is an advice to the rest of the ummah to the Day of Judgment. So any advice that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives to the Sahaba, whether individually or in a group, it is an advice to every single member of the nation of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the Day of Judgment. Now the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving Abdullah ibn Umar an advice. What's this advice? كن في الدنيا كأنك غريب أو عابر سبيل. Oh Abdullah, live in this dunya, live in this world as a stranger or a traveler. What does it mean, living this dunya as a stranger? When you come to my house, and you come to my house as a guest, Are you going to come in my house and start looking which bedroom you're going to be living in? And how you're going to put the TV? And which couch you're going to be sitting on? And which chair you want to start using? You come into my house for an objective, for a goal. Visit, complain, have a fight, wa Allah ma'ak. You come in and out. You don't go in because you want to, okay, let's restructure this house and refurbish this house and do that. That's none of your business. You come into my house as a stranger, ahla wa sahlan as a guest. You walk in, you acquire or gain or earn the objective that you came for, and then you go. And that's your way of life in this dunya. You are not to live in this dunya forever. Eternity is for you in the hereafter, in the paradise, not in this dunya. So don't mix up between the two. You are in this dunya temporarily. You are in this dunya only for a short space of time. You are in this dunya not forever, only temporary in this dunya. Your everlasting and eternity that you are looking for, it's in the paradise. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you an eternal life in the paradise. It's not going to give you an eternal life in this dunya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give the eternity to anyone. So, how do you live your life in this dunya? You live in this life as a stranger or a traveler. What's a traveler? I just came back from Hajj not long ago, about a month and a bit. A month and a half ago. Who went to Hajj? 15 days, travelers, it's Hajj. When I arrived there, did I go and find, or did I go and look for a house to live in? Or a car to buy? Or a job for me to start earning an income from? You go and find an objective. You are a traveler. Whether you're going there for a ritual, or you're going there for tourism, or you're going to visit someone, or you're going to do a quick business transaction. You are going as a traveler. You go and do what you need to do and you come back. Why? Because you know you're not going to live there forever. So you don't plan forever. You just get in and out. And that's your way of life in this dunya. You are in this dunya, but as soon as that you find yourself in this dunya, you're going to be out. So don't live in this dunya forever and think that you're going to be living in this dunya forever. You're not going to live in this dunya forever. You're only living in this dunya temporarily. And then, bye-bye, you're gone. You're going to go like everyone else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which the soul of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam is the most honorable soul to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what does Allah azza wa say to the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam? Innaka mayitun wa innahum mayitun. O Muhammad, you shall taste death and they shall taste death. Everyone will taste death. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants you to live your life in this dunya as a stranger or a traveler. Someone who is just going past as a transit, or someone who's just a stranger, not intending to live in this world forever and moving on. Because at the end of the day, you're not going to live in this dunya forever. So what did Abdullah ibn Umar say? He said, after the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after this invaluable advice from the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, this precious advice from the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, Abdullah ibn Umar started to live by this principle. What's this principle that he had laid for himself? He said, إِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الصَّبَاحِ. If it's at night, then wait for the morning to come. Because you don't know, you might not even encounter the morning. وَإِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ مَسَاء. And if it's in the morning, don't wait for the evening, because you don't know if you're going to live to the evening. Right now it's night, it's evening for us. Do you have any guarantees? Someone put your hand up and say, you know what? I've got full guarantee that I'm going to be alive tomorrow. I dare you to put your hand up. You know what? I dare you to even put your hand up and say, you know what? There is 10% possibility for me to be alive tomorrow morning. You can't even dare to say that. The possibility of you not making it the following day is by far a lot more greater than the possibility of you making it the following day. إِذَا أَصْبَحْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الْمَسَاءِ وَإِذَا أَمْسَيْتَ فَلَا تَنْتَظِرِ الصَّبَاحِ. If it's in the morning, don't wait for the evening to come. And if it's the evening, don't wait for the morning to come. وَخُذْ مِنْ صَحَّتِكَ لِمَرَضِكَ وَمِنْ حَيَاتِكَ لِمَوْتِكَ. And take from your health, like during your healthy days, take something from your healthy days for your ill days, for your unhealthy days. And from your life for your death. Take advantage. You're alive now. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given you the opportunity for you to breathe air on the face of this earth. Tomorrow you're not going to breathe air. You're going to be under the ground. 6 foot under. You'll be gone. Like how many people in the past are gone? They were gone and you're going to go. إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ You shall taste death and they shall taste death. But at the end of the day, what did you do? And that's why Abdullah ibn Umar, what did he say? If you are in the morning, don't wait for the evening. If it's the evening, don't wait for the morning. And prepare for your death. What's happening right now, my brothers and my sisters, we are preparing for everything. We are preparing what we're going to do after 20 years. My retirement. Right now, everyone's talking about retirement. He's 16 years old and he's talking about his retirement. 16 years old, inshallah, when I retire. Like, you haven't even started for you to retire. You haven't even started for you to retire. Yeah, they're in the 20s and 30s, they're talking about their retirement. I'm not saying that's wrong. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that's wrong. But I'm saying that we are preparing and planning for the future. You should be preparing and planning for the big future. What's the big future? The paradise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared. Because if you're not going to be in the paradise, I'm sorry to tell you, you're going to be on the other side. What's the other side? You're going to be in the hellfire. Because it's either paradise or hellfire. If you're unprepared, my brother and my sister in Islam, if you're not going to prepare yourself for the paradise, you're going to be on the other side. You're going to be in another place. What's the other place? Hellfire. So subhanAllah, look at this invaluable advice from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and from Abdullah ibn Umar. But at the same time, my brothers and my sisters, you shouldn't live in reluctance or resentment. Oh, you know what? There's no need for me to work hard. There's no need for me to educate myself. Today, Sheikh Shadi told us, don't even work for the next day. So there's no need for me to go to work tomorrow because he doesn't know if I'm going to work or not. Don't even go for a contract or don't even prepare yourself. Don't thrive your business. Don't even educate yourself. That's stupidity. That's stupidity at its peak. No. You live your life as you are going to live forever when it comes to your worldly matters. But at the same time, when it comes to your religion, as if you're dying tomorrow. So when it comes for preparation, when it comes for planning for your dunya, you plan forever. But when it comes for your akhirah, you plan for today. So you could keep yourself always vigilant and conscious of what's going to happen tomorrow. So we've got the dunya and we've got the hereafter. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not neglect your portion of this dunya. You have a responsibility in this dunya. You need to be the best in this dunya. You need to thrive in your business. You need to thrive in your family. You need to thrive in your education. But when it comes to your akhirah, you need to be prepared. It's all about that balance. And I've spoken about balance so many times. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam urges the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu, urges the Muslim Ummah, urges you as a member of the nation of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a follower of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is encouraging you to prepare yourself for the big day. Are you ready or not? No one dares to say, I'm ready. Who dares to say, I'm ready to face Allah Azza wa Jalla? Everyone knows the shortcomings that they had in their lives. Everyone knows. I know my shortcomings. You know your shortcomings. Every single one of us knows their shortcomings. We all know our shortcomings. That's why none of us is ready to die. If the angel of death now knocks on your door and says, look, it's time. Your time is up and it's time for you to die. Are you ready? No one's going to say, you know what, alhamdulillah, I've been prayed. Ya Allah, Habibi, ta'al. No one is ready. And obviously, that's not going to happen. You know, it's not going to happen. Don't think the angel of death is going to say, you ready, Habibi? When you ready, inshallah, I'm outside. Just let me know. Just give me a shout. Let me know when you're ready and I'll come in. It's not going to happen. It only happens with prophets and messengers. Prophets and messengers are the only ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commanded the angel of death to seek their permission before he takes their soul. But you, as an ordinary human being, like myself and you, the angel of death is not going to knock on our door. You're going to find yourself, bang, that's it, gone. Bye-bye, you're out of this dunya. Watching yourself dead. Ascending in the horizon. He's not going to come and knock on your door and give you the opportunity or give you that time for you to get yourself ready. Yalla, kiss bye-bye to your family and tell them I'm going. It's not going to happen. It could be at any moment. It could happen at any moment. Now, later, tomorrow, but it's going to happen one day. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that. Another hadith here, وعن عبد الله ابن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه قال خط النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خطا مربعا وخط خطا في الوسط خارجا منه، وخط خططا صغارا إلى هذا الذي في الوسط من جانبه الذي في الوسط، فقال: هذا الإنسان وهذا أجله محيطا به أو قد أحاط به، وهذا الذي هو خارج أمله، وهذه الخطط الصغار الأعراض، فإن أخطأه هذا نهشه هذا، وإن أخطأه هذا نهشه هذا. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم just to draw the Sahaba رضي الله تعالى عنهم to him. One day when the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم was sitting in the masjid during the time of the Prophet Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, there wasn't carpets. There weren't carpet in the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. So mashallah, right now you've got a carpet. And it's a nice carpet. And we paid a lot of money for it, for your information. So just, you know, put that on the side. Okay? So during the time of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, they didn't have carpet, they didn't have straw mats, they didn't have any of that. They used to pray on the dust, on the sand. And when it rains, it's mud. So Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم is surrounded by the Sahaba رضي الله تعالى عنهم. And what did the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم do? There's two different narrations on this one. Or it could be two different events. And Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم drew a line in the sand. So there was a line. One horizontal line. And then the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم drew vertical lines opposite direction to the horizontal line. So now one line, and then lines like this coming out from one side, from the above the line, and lines vertically coming from the bottom of the line. In one narration, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, this is the path of Allah. So straight. No crookedness in it. Straight. It's a straight path. No deviance, no crookedness, no misguidance. It's a straight path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam points at the vertical lines, and this is the misguided lines, misguided paths. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention in the Quran Kareem, وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about His path, when Allah azza wa speaks about His guidance, it's one path. But misguidance, it's not one path. It's numerous paths, a lot of paths. One path takes you to Allah, but to the hellfire, take it from me, there's a lot of paths that take you to the hellfire. There's only one direction, only one path to the Jannah, one path to the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal. But the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the hellfire, you'll find a lot of paths that take you to the hellfire. So how many paths does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have? Allah has only one path. وَأَنَّ هَذَا صِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا. This is my path. But the deviant and misguided paths are more than one. There's a lot. There's a lot of paths that take you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another hadith, this one that we just read before, in which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had drawn a number of paths. He drew a number of lines. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam describes, this is the path that takes you to Allah and the challenges that surround your path. One challenge can get the better of you. Another challenge can take you down. But at the end of the day, you're a believer. You need to overcome those challenges. This is the picture that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is displaying to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu. You live in this dunya with many challenges. And the biggest challenge is death. The biggest challenge is death. We don't look at it as a challenge. We look at it as a destiny. That's it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had written this on me. I'm going to die. Yes. But did you know that death is also a challenge? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests you through death? My brothers and my sisters, even when you're on your deathbed, when you're on your deathbed, and the biggest challenge in your life is when you're on your deathbed, about to die, and your soul is about to come out, angel of death will come to take it out. And then you are struggling through the process of death, sakratul maut, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran Kareem, وَجَاءَتْ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ. When the process and the agony of death comes near, and you're on your deathbed, surrounded by your family, weeping and crying, and everyone just looking at you, please come back. And you could see the angel of death coming. That's the biggest challenge. when you struggle to say and to make your final words, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Because the Prophet Muhammad says, whoever dies and their final word is أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَٰهِ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ, they'll enter the Jannah. That's the guarantee of the Prophet Muhammad. But don't think about it, you know, alhamdulillah, that's not hard. Simple, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّ رَسُولُهُ. No. Now it's simple, but on your deathbed, it's the hardest thing for you to utter. The hardest thing for you to say. So don't look at it, wallah, it's simple. I've been saying أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. Even my cockatoo can even say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. My baby can say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله. No, you're wrong. It's going to be so difficult. It's going to be so challenging for you to say those words. Because during that moment, the only thing that will come on your tongue is what you sacrifice for in this dunya. If you sacrifice for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you sacrifice for this kalima, ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, in which way you are doing right now, sacrificing for this kalima, then Allah azza wa jalla make it easy on your tongue and you say, ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu Muhammad Rasulullah. But if you didn't sacrifice for this kalima, you didn't sacrifice for this word, you didn't sacrifice for Allah azza wa jalla, Allahu alam, what are you going to say? You could be saying money, 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 honey, 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 you could be saying anything. You could be saying wife, 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 kids, kids, kids. You could be saying business. You could be talking about some actor or singer they used to look up to. You're on your deathbed and you are struggling to say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله, and you are probably calling upon Michael Jackson. I'm old school, don't worry. You're probably calling upon him. You're probably calling upon some superstar that you took as a superstar. You could be calling upon them, you could be calling upon some sportsman they used to look up to. So don't look at it, wallah, that's easy. No, it's not easy. And then, and listen to this, that one, wallahi, that one petrifies me. When I think about it, wallahi, it petrifies me. My brothers and my sisters, did you know that when you're on your deathbed and you're about to die, and you could imagine that scene, and as much as you imagine that scene, you will never ever get the reality or the virtual reality of that scene. You're never going to get that reality because it's something beyond your imagination. We always compare ourselves to someone else when it comes to things like that. You feel sorry for this person that passed away. You feel sorry for this person that stands before Allah Azza wa Jalla hereafter, and then he'll be thrown in the hellfire. You feel sorry for this person that's dying, and you feel sorry for this person that's been punished in the hellfire. You feel sorry for this person that's been punished in the graveyard. Feel sorry for yourself. Because you're going to be in that position sooner or later. So you need to do something about it. So what I'm going to tell you is something that really petrifies me. Did you know, my brother and my sister, that when you're on your deathbed and you are concerned about everything and everyone, and the most thing that you are concerned about is yourself, because you're about to encounter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or maybe even the punishment of Allah azza wa jalla. So you're on your deathbed here. You're on your deathbed. So you're not really thinking about money, because what money going to help you now? You're not thinking about your house, you're not thinking about your business, you're not thinking about your cars. You know what? You're probably not even thinking about your family. Especially if you have some iman, a bit of iman. The only thing that you're thinking about is how I'm going to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So imagine, you're on your deathbed and you could see death is near. Above your head, the angel of death is about to take your soul. And now you want to prepare yourself to say, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. You know what the Prophet Muhammad said? He said, during that moment, your mother or your father that passed away, or maybe not your mother or your father, maybe someone that you used to look up to that had passed away, shaitan will come in their figure. Shaitan will come in their disguise. So imagine you're on your deathbed and you could see the angel of death coming near, and you want to prepare yourself. I'm about to die. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa Muhammadur Rasulullah. I'm about to disconnect from this dunya. And may Allah Azza wa Jal, you look towards your right and you're looking at your mother that passed away, your father that passed away, or maybe the sheikh that you used to look up to. And then they'll come to you. It's not your mother or your father or the sheikh. That's the shaitan coming in the figure of your mother, your father, or the person they used to look up to. And then you know he will come to you, and you know what he say to you? Just think about it. Think about that moment. Think about the agony of death. Think about what's going through your mind. and think about what you are preparing yourself for, and then you look towards your right, mom, dad, sheikh, brother, teacher, master, whoever it is. And shaitan comes to you in the form of your mother. Shaitan comes to you in the form of your dead father. And then shaitan will say to you, son, daughter, do not die on Islam. We died on Islam when we found Islam not to be the true religion. Allahu Akbar. Just think about that. Imagine, you're on your deathbed. Angel of death is above you, about to take your soul, to snatch it out of your body. And then you look towards your right or your left, it's your mom and your dad who passed away, calling upon you, saying to your son, don't die on Islam. We died on Islam and we found out that Islam is not the true religion. What are you going to do? I'm telling you right now, you're going to buckle. You're going to buckle. And then you'll be stuck between saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, or saying, I don't believe in Allah and I don't even believe Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthens and empowers those who believed in him in this dunya and the hereafter. Your iman, your belief in Allah Azza wa Jal, your adherence to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your obedience to Allah Azza wa Jal will make you strong during that moment. Even though you see that shaitan coming in the form of your mother or your father, you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu rasuluh, and you die on the shahada. But if you are someone with weak iman, then pray, then fast, commit the haram, involved in the haram, live in the haram, speak to the haram, listen to the haram, utter with the haram, oh, your entire life is haram. What do you expect going to happen? You told me you're going to be strong? No, I'm going to be strong, inshallah. Trust me. No, I'm not going to trust you. Be strong in what? If you're really strong, you'll be strong right now. If you're alive, you're not even strong. You told me when you're on your deathbed, you're going to be strong? If you're really strong, you'll be strong while you're alive, not when you die. Big test. And that's what the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is illustrating. That this is your life. Just continue with your life. Pursue your life in the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal. And you are surrounded with all these challenges. You don't know which challenge will pop up. Until the end of this life. Until the last moment of your life. Until the last moment you breathe air. You're going to find the challenge coming in. And you'll continue to be challenged. Even when you're on your deathbed, don't think, Allah, you are going to die and that's it, no more challenges. Challenges will continue to follow you and pursue you even while you're on your deathbed. So prepare yourself. يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. Allah strengthens, Allah empowers those who believe in Him and those who adhere to Him in this dunya and the hereafter. So my brother and my sister, if you're not strong now, you're not going to be strong later on. Don't deceive yourself. Sometimes we befool ourselves. Yes, we befool ourselves. We think, oh, you know what, alhamdulillah, I'm going to do it. No, it doesn't work that way. It's not up to you at the end of the day. Where's your iman? Where's your taqwa? And that's the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. These are the teachings of the Prophet Alayhi Salatu Wasallam. Subhanallah, we're so lucky, my brothers and my sisters. We are so fortunate that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala made us from the ummah of the Prophet Alayhi Salatu Wasallam. And we are more fortunate to be here tonight, in which we are learning about the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla, understanding the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn it, practice it, put it into practice, live it the way the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived it. I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us from amongst those who listen and hear and act upon what they listen and hear. Inshallah, we'll continue with this next week, inshallah, more on this chapter, remembering death and the consequences of death. We are one mama who should stand with each other through all the highs and lows.